All right, let's do this. Here is the first of many videos. I have now made this. This is take number 7. So I have been making mistakes every single time. I'm going into like, say, 5 minutes into the video and not getting through it. So we're going to do this video whether I make any mistakes or at all. So I really apologize if you see me messing up along the way. But apart from any kind of accidental F-bombs, I am not stopping. So away we go. The first question, and by the way, these are all the questions that you asked me from the question triangle. Thank you so much for asking them. I love it when you ask me questions about this stuff. It means you're actually thinking about everything and you're curious about it. I love it. Keep it up. Keep it up is all I have to say. So here we go. What's the first question? If ionic bonds are so crazy strong, then why do they break down when a salt goes in water? Good question. Because really, kind of doesn't make sense, because the first thing I said was those ionic bonds, man, it's hard to break them. They're really, really strongly attracted to each other, and it's really almost impossible to break them. And then I come along and say, and when you dip it in water, boom, they're broken. And you're like, what? So here we go. Let's try to answer this. Now, before I get into it, I just want to make it really clear. Everything I'm talking about here is not what you need to know for a test. You don't need to know this for the unit. This is extra information. It's just to help you understand things clearer. I will never ask you any of this in a test. It is additional stuff. So without further ado, let's take a look at a happy little lattice. So look at the lattice. It's so happy. So we have, what do we got here? We have a happy little, maybe I should write some of this stuff down. Hang on. So what do I got? I've got over here, I have a happy little chloride ion. Over here, I've got a little sodium ion. And because one is positively charged and one is negatively charged, there is an attractive force between them. And we call those forces the electrostatic forces. So there's an electrostatic force between everything that is oppositely charged. In other words, there's one between these and this one, and it's keeping it's all over the place. These are all attract each other through these forces because they are oppositely charged. They are, and remember, the reason why they are charged in the first place is because they have an imbalance of the number of protons and the number of electrons in the atom itself. In order to become an ion, it had to either gain or lose an electron, and therefore there's a different number of protons versus the number of electrons, and therefore we have a charge. So that's the basic idea. And it arranges itself in a really neat grid. This is why we call it a lattice. So it is a lattice in a grid form. Just automatically, this is the way it works for almost everything. There's not usually too much differentiation between these things. This is generally how they work out. And everybody's happy. Everybody, look at them. It's so happy. So what gives? What's going to come up next that's going to ruin everything? Oh, well, you know what's going to happen. Water. Water's going to happen. And water's going to ruin everything for us. So why? So let's talk about what water is. First off, you notice that I've drawn it totally differently. In other words, the hydrogen and the oxygen seem to be mushed together. They're sort of this kind of like, you know, the orbits are sort of interlocking with each other. And that is because this is a covalently bonded molecule. This is not an ionic bond. Water is not an ionic bonded compound. It is a covalently bonded compound. It is a molecule. And therefore, what we know about those is that they are neutral. In other words, the number of protons equals the number of electrons. And as a result, the total charge is zero. So great, it's zero. What does that mean for us? Well, for one thing, it tells us a little bit about how water would be reacting to everything else in this soup. So here we have a little water molecule. I just drew a little nice one there. And so what can it do? Oh, it doesn't even react to anything. It just kind of goes wee, and it can move very freely around everything because it's not interacting with the charged particles. it can just kind of do this. So let's just say it hangs out right here for a moment. Say right here. Okay. So it gets up close. And now I've got to add something new, something we haven't talked about. Let's go back. Let's go back to this thing. And I said, this is a covalently bonded molecule. It's neutral, blah, blah, blah. But let me add something. But maybe I should. But the charges are not distributed. What should I say? Evenly. The charges are not, in other words, there's not a uniform, what we might call uniform distribution. They're not equally spaced all over this thing. And what we would say is that actually with the oxygen, we have a slight difference in what's charged. In other words, the hydrogens over at this end have a little more of a balance of positive. You notice I made this little symbol here. That's actually the symbol we use to say that this thing is partially got a little bit of a slight imbalance along it. Remember, there is no extra electrons. There is no extra protons. It just happens that there's more of a positive charge on this side. And over here, there's a little bit more of a negative charge on this side. And what we call this is a polar molecule. In other words, because one end of it, of the whole molecule, is a little more negatively charged, and also because of the geometry, notice that the hydrogens actually have this kind of angle. They're on two sides, and I've actually drawn this fairly accurate as far as the water molecule looks. It does kind of look like this in terms of the hydrogen not being on opposite sides of each other, but a little bit more of an angle, right? There's kind of a connection. Whoops, whoa. There's kind of a connection here where this is sort of an angle here between the two hydrogens, like this and this. So all this is actually on purpose. This is actually what they look like. And so as a result, there's kind of an axis, kind of a line right down the middle like this, where I could say that this is sort of partially negative. And then down here is partially positive. And so I would almost like saying there's a north and south pole. This is why I call it a polar molecule. The result being is that I actually have what's known as a dipole. So this is why we have this really strange little symbol. This is actually kind of a sort of a little D. So this is a negative dipole and this is a positive dipole. And what we mean by this is that, yes, it's neutral, but if you got close enough, this thing would probably orient itself a little bit according to these sides. So let's go back for a moment to what we had before. Because if that's the case, let's go over to our little happy water molecule. And let me just see here. It's going to move around. Whee, I'm moving around. But then, remember, it comes close enough to say the sodium. And what happens is that since the oxygen side is a little negatively charged, it will slowly and get a little bit attracted. And it'll hang out. It'll hang out just like that. Apply. Great. So it kind of almost sticks there. It kind of starts to surround, you know, just hangs out. It turns and faces the positive side. If this was the chloride, it would be the other side would be facing it. But in this case, we're talking about the positive charge. And so obviously the negative side would turn towards it because the sides attract. But then, well, wait a minute. That's not the only water molecule hanging around. So then suddenly there's another one showing up. Whee! And it also will do the same thing. It also will kind of go whoop and kind of do that. And is it going to stop there? Hell no. No, of course not. There's going to be another one. Another water molecule will come around and it also goes, hey, what's going on? And it goes, oh, I want to turn and kind of, I feel a little bit of an attraction to this. And so what we're talking about is this really interesting process where we keep getting water molecules surrounding everything. Surrounding. And this is happening all over the place. So what happens is that they surround, and there could be many more. I'm just not going to draw them all like this. And as a result, because they're surrounding everything, they've disrupted this bond that it has with the neighboring chlorides, which means all of this now can kind of drift away because it's not actually interacting with anything. It's not able to have those electrostatic forces because it's surrounded by these neutral. Remember, in the end, I know they're attracted when they get really close, but overall, those water molecules are neutral. And just like before, they can wander anywhere they want. So they leave. They leave. There they go. Boom. And now what's left? Well, wait a minute. Now there's this big gap. It's like this opening in the entire thing, in my lattice. But my lattice can't handle having openings. Because what's happening is that, yeah, there's still electrostatic forces, but these are not attractive anymore. These are now repelling forces. And so this thing will start to shake the entire structure of this lattice. Because this is happening everywhere. So this isn't the only gap that's showing up. These gaps are showing up all over the place. And this is not just happening with the sodium. This is also, because remember what I said, is that I could also have the water all surrounding the chloride ions. And this is happening all over the place. What we're talking about is a process known as solvation. And this is how it generally works with almost anything that dissolves in water, is that the water molecules are polarized. So since they're polar molecules, and they have a little bit of a negative side and a little bit of a positive side, they will then do this thing where they surround atoms and then are able to carry them away. And as a result, break down what might have been a really strong structure of electrostatic forces originally. That pretty much is the way this works. I don't know if I covered it entirely, but you might have to watch the video one more time to get a full beat on this. If you have more questions about this, please let me know. But otherwise, I'll move on to the next question. Let me see. I'm just going to let this thing wander again because it's just having a great old time. Yay! Okay. So I'll just do the next video. Okay, thanks. Bye.